In the last lecture in this course, we focused on ecological complexity and tried to explore a number of the branches or flavors of ecology that are used to try and understand that complexity. At the end of that lecture, we said that the next lecture, that is this one, would be about how that complexity came to be. And in essence, that means the evolution of the diversity of life. And that evolution is, of course, Charles Darwin's insight, and we are sort of converting then using the same closing passages of The Origin of Species from this idea of a tangled bank of ecological complexity to the realization that this has all been evolved from a single common ancestor through mainly the process of natural selection, but also other evolutionary processes. And this lecture is about attempting to explain, understand, unify, and connect those different concepts together. Starting with a formal-ish lecture that we'll give now, and then after that, I'll give a live interpretive dance that attempts to weave together the different evolutionary mechanisms. The introductory materials set the stage for this evolutionary thinking by making reference to the historical progression of thought about the way evolution worked in the Galapagos Islands. And let's cut back to the Galapagos Islands to introduce the rest of this part of the lecture.
Do you see those two weevils, Doctor?
I do.
Which would you choose?
Neither. There's not a scrap of difference between them. They're the same species of Calculio.
If you had to choose, if you were forced to make a choice, if there was no other response...
Well, then, if you're going to push me... I would choose the right-hand weevil. It has significant advantage in both length and breadth.
There! I have you. You're completely dished. Do you not know that in the Cerberus, one must always choose the lesser of two weevils?
That movie was basically making a joke about weevils and trying to link it to evolution and natural selection. And indeed, there are weevils in Galapagos. So here's an image of several of the weevils that have been described in Galapagos. Now, these weevils are a part of a much larger group of other weevils. And weevils are one of the most diverse groups of animals on the planet. So for example, here was a recent study that described 98 new species of weevil in Indonesia. Some of these weevils are super, super, super cool. They show striking color patterns and dramatic morphological innovations. Here's just a few examples. Some Papuan weevils have what they call screw-in legs. And then there's also giraffe weevils, where the males have these really long necks and they use them to sort of joust with each other. So you can take any group of organisms, here you can take weevils, and you can attempt to understand their relationships by means of a phylogeny, or an evolutionary tree or a phylogenetic tree that represents the history of descent and relationships among the different species in that tree. For Galapagos, using morphological and then molecular techniques, people have built a phylogeny of the Galapagos weevils and their close relatives on the mainland and other islands. So the tips of these branches show connections between pairs of species that represent sister species, they call them. That is, they are the most recently diverged pair of new species from a single common ancestor represented by the junction of those two different branches. And then that common ancestor will be connected to other branches in the phylogeny via those other connections. So here you have the set of relationships among the Galapagos weevils, and then if you continue out to their presumed common ancestor that would have colonized the Galapagos Islands, you see the connection to outgroups, that is, groups of weevils that are not found on the Galapagos. So this is just a tiny section of the weevil evolutionary tree, family tree, that is nested within a much bigger tree of the rest of the weevils. Now, this tree now depicts the relationships among all of the different weevil groups, with representative species having been sequenced within each of those representative groups. And so you see the Galapagos species are found in where that red arrow shows, and they're nested within this much larger set of relationships among other weevils that go back in time. So So as you move up the tree, you're essentially moving backward in time. And those weevils are themselves nested within the evolutionary tree of beetles. So here's an evolutionary phylogeny of the major groups of beetles, Coleoptera. And you can see the weevils, which represent 70 to 97,000 species or so, down at the bottom. And those are nested within this larger beetle phylogeny. So some common ancestor to all these beetles generated these different beetle groups through time. And then each of those beetle groups have diversified into other groups, such as the weevils within the weevil group. They diversified into these major groups and clades and lineages within the beetles. One of those was then the one that gave rise to the Galapagos. And then on the Galapagos, there was another expansion into the set of Galapagos species, like a little mini radiation of weevils, just like there's a radiation of finches. Now there's lots and lots of beetles, roughly 400,000 species of them, which are about 40% of all of the insect species. And they're nested within this phylogeny of the rest of the insects. So you can see the branch, the red arrow is pointing to right there, that represents the common ancestor of all of the beetles. And then the tree shows the relationships among those, represented now as a circle, where moving out from the center of the circle outward, you have increasing time. And so the branches are shown as distances from the center, which is the origin. The insects, of course, are nested within that larger group of the rest of the species on Earth. Now, this diversity of life is constantly varying through space and time as a result of ecological and evolutionary processes. So on the top phylogeny, you see a hypothetical representation of as you go away from the origin, you have increasing time in the history of life on Earth. And then you have splits that represent the different groups that we're going to talk about through this course, including fish and amphibians and reptiles, birds and mammals. Those are going to be my part of the course. And then the bottom, you see the history of diversity of particular marine genera. And you can see that it generally increases, but you have the major extinction events that tend to correspond to the ones that we think of, like five major extinction events. And of course, we're entering the sixth extinction event right now. Now, this evolutionary or phylogenetic diversity also varies across space. And so you can see variation across the globe in the richness of species in each of the different groups. And you can see there are certain particular regional hotspots or geographical hotspots of diversity, such as the Andes for terrestrial life and Southeast Asia, and then also Southeast Asia when it comes to marine life. So there's a ton of work attempting to understand the evolutionary and ecological processes that are generating and maintaining the diversity in particular regions in comparison to other regions. An absolutely key point here is that this great diversity of life and its variation across space and time has evolutionary origins. And the rest of this lecture, I want to talk about the particular evolutionary mechanisms that shape the diversity of those organisms and the traits, the characteristics that they have. Now, in order to talk about these evolutionary mechanisms, I first have to just do a little reminder about the nature of genetic variation. And the first thing is that we tend to think about genetic variation in a Mendelian context. The classic Gregor Mendel's peas, the monk, the Austrian monk, who basically discovered the rules of heredity, and then they were kind of lost for 50 years or so before being rediscovered in the early 1900s. So here you see, you know, you have short peas, and so we'll call their allele for being short, little a, and so those are homozygous little a's. You mate them with homozygous big a's, and then you generate all heterozygotes. All those heterozygotes in this case are all intermediates in height. Then you cross the heterozygotes together, which gives you back some homozygous little a's, some homozygous big a's. 25% is the expectation for each of those, and 50% the expectation that for heterozygotes, which of course are the same height as the parent generation, that is the F1 hybrids that you generated previously. Let's just consider one gene with two possible alleles, like you saw in the previous slide. They're going to be called something different in the second slide. That is, instead of little a and big A, they're going to be X subscript 1 and X subscript 2. Now, these diploid individuals will have two copies of this gene, so they'll have one allele from one parent and one allele from the other parent. Now, an individual, therefore, can be one of three different genotypes if there's only two alleles for this one gene. That is, as we said in the previous, they can be homozygous big A, big A, heterozygous big A, little a, or homozygous little a, little a. Now, genetic variation, therefore evolution, is possible if you have variation in the population. So this is a population, a group of organisms that are interbreeding, and each of the ovals within inside the larger circle represents an individual, and then each of those individuals in this case has two possible alleles, that is X1, X2, or X3, shown as different colors, and each individual has a diploid genotype, so two alleles, like we were just saying. So to figure out how evolution is going to proceed, you calculate what's called the allele frequencies in this population. And in this example, it just means counting up all of the alleles of each type, X1, X2, or X3. So if you do that, you get numbers like this. There's 12 X1 alleles out of a total of 60 alleles within this population. There are 30 X2 alleles, and there are 18 X3 alleles. So that means that the starting allele frequencies in the population at this point in time, in this single locus Mendelian context where we're dealing with three alleles right now, three possible alleles, is 20% for X1, 50% for X2, and 30% for X3. Now, evolution occurs when those frequencies change through time. So this is Mendelian variation, how we think about it, and its evolution. But if you look out in nature, you don't see usually these discrete types, that is short, small, and intermediate. Instead, you see a big mixture. And my own personal experience with all kinds of wildlife suggests that that's the case. You don't just see alternative types that would be easily represented by Mendelian variation of a single gene. Instead, you see what's called quantitative variation in a lot of cases. And this is polygenic, meaning it's influenced by many genes. So the famous example was for the Agricultural College, I think it's the ROTC, the Agricultural College in Connecticut, where they had all the students line up behind signposts that corresponded to their height. So I went searching for some other examples of this polygenic variation to show you how common it was, and I found this one on the lower left, just searching on Google, and amazingly, it's actually a figure of data that I provided to this textbook that corresponds to the beak sizes of Darwin's finches. So you see there's not small or large, there's variation from all the way from very small to very large. When we talk about evolution of this type of variation, we don't talk about changes in allele frequency directly. Instead, we talk about changes in the average value of the population. What's the average height? And how is that evolving through time? This quantitative polygenic variation really is just taking the Mendelian genetic variation and extending it to multiple alleles, multiple genes. So if, for example, you have six different genes over here, and you do your Mendelian crosses, you end up in the second generation with this normal distribution. All of these traits, but particularly quantitative traits, also have strong environmental influences, such as body height in humans. It's highly polygenic, but it also is heavily influenced by how much you eat. Okay, so we have two different complementary ways of looking at evolutionary change. Sometimes we look at changes in allele frequency, and other times we can ask about changes in the mean values of these quantitative traits, like average beak size of Darwin's finches. So let's talk about evolutionary mechanisms now. Here they are again, using one or the other of these types of genetic variation. The first evolutionary mechanism we can start with is obviously mutation. Check out this frog here. This is not a fake. It's not a Photoshop. It's a real toad found hopping around in someone's garden. And it's not the only case where that kind of toad has been found. Here's another example. So sometimes there's a mutation that occurs that influences the direction of development, the polarity of development of the eyes in toads, and such that the eyes end up in the mouth. So this is a macro mutation. Now, most macro mutations like this aren't going to survive, that is big effect mutations like this. So mutations change the genetic code, so it's a change in sequence, and here's a whole series of different ways in which you can get those changes in sequence via base pair insertions, base pair deletions, or mutations to stop codons, or whatever. And so these mutations change the genetic code, which generates new alleles. So as soon as you change the genetic code at a gene, you've created a new allele, X1, X2, X3. You have another type of mutation, now you have X4. And you have four alleles segregating in the population. So these new alleles sometimes will change amino acid sequences, as you can see here, the protein sequences of amino acids. Or they can alter gene expression, that is, the amount of product produced by a gene, which can then have phenotypic effects, effects on the external characteristics of the organism. Now, people have estimated how frequent mutations are, and the best estimates come from things that can be easily sequenced and studied, such as nematodes or roundworms. And so basically, in roundworms, there's about one mutation every 100 million nucleotides that are copied during DNA replication. And so that might be kind of typical of humans as well, where each of us carries, on average, one or two new mutations that occurred in the gametes of our parents. Some of these mutations, as I was saying, will have external phenotypic effects, and here are some of the ones that have been characterized in fruit flies, Drosophila, and you can see these are different ones associated with the eyes or the wings, and you can basically go to a living bank, if you will, of Drosophila and order up your mutations for the research you might want to do. Generally, our phenotypes work pretty well, which means that our genomes, through the product of selection, natural selection in the past, have created something that works pretty well. So if you're just throwing random mutations at your body, at your genome, then you're most likely going to mess something up, make it worse. So most mutations are going to be deleterious, as they're going to reduce survival and mating, reproductive success. Now, the average mutation, the estimates suggest, reduce fitness by about 2%. Most mutations have no effect whatsoever, actually, because they don't change the amino acid sequence, for example. So these few beneficial mutations are going to be a small effect. That is, hopeful monsters, as they're called, like that toad, are going to be rare, because most of those mutations aren't going to be good. If you make a big change, it's most likely going to be really messing you up. The things that might improve populations through time would be small effect improvements. However, large effect beneficial mutations do occur, at least ones that have really obvious external effects, such as the classic industrial melanism in peppered moths that you may have read about in as an example of evolution. Now, how do the frequencies of the alleles that have been generated by mutation and moved around, how do they change within populations? We're going to talk about several different mechanisms, the first of which is genetic drift. And genetic drift generates random changes in allele frequency. Perhaps the easiest way to think about it is to take this population, that's the same one that we talked about before with the starting allele frequencies, and just to have a meteorite come down and kill some of them at random. So I just threw this thing down on this population at random. So you've got the survivors there. Now you want to figure out what happens by the next generation. So let's just assume each survivor here just clones itself and then dies. So we have the next generation. So we can count them up as we did before. Here are the numbers. Now there's only 3 X1s, 15 X2s, and 6 X3s out of a total of 24 in this case, which yields these allele frequencies. And so you can see that the frequency of each allele has changed within the population. That's evolution. Evolution occurred. But it was random. It did not have anything to do with whether they were X1, X2, or X3, green, blue, or red. It was just random.
Hey, you know what? It's movie time. Time to take a good intermission from the lecture and watch a good movie. This is called Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead. Really, really good movie, one of my favorites, by Tom Stoppard from one of his plays. About two peripheral characters from Hamlet and their adventures in and outside of Hamlet. So let's check it out. So coins are random, right? You flip it, heads or tails, equal probability, and yet he's flipped it a whole bunch of times in a row. Now, initially there's no surprise in that, right? Because you can imagine flipping heads 4 times in a row and it wouldn't be any cause for alarm. But the longer it goes on, the less likely you'd think it was random. you start to think there must be something deterministic about it, like maybe one hot side is heavier weighted, or
heads.
Maybe it's actually heads on both sides.
Heads.
Which, of course, is what Rosencrantz, or is it Guildenstern, is thinking.
Heads.
The more it goes on, the more implausible it seems. So this demonstrates an important principle of random genetic drift, and that is that it's much more effective in small populations. If you have a small population, just a few individuals, you can see really rapid shifts from one generation to the next in allele frequencies. So evolution can happen rapidly through this random chances. Further and further it goes, though, larger and larger your sample, larger and larger the population, the less likely you would expect chance to be important. If you flip a coin 10,000 times, you can be pretty sure you're going to be right around 5,000 plus or minus heads and 5,000 plus or minus tails. Random genetic drift. So you can do simulations on the computer that show this, or you can do experiments in natural populations that also show this, that random genetic drift has big effects in small populations, but not in large populations. Great movie. Let's keep watching.
What I want to do now is I want to change to shift to non-random changes that occur through several different mechanisms. The most important by far is natural selection. Now, natural selection, of course, was the insight of Charles Darwin and Alfred Russel Wallace, and they published joint papers about this very interesting story. I don't have time to tell you about. In the Proceedings of the Linnaean Society. Subsequently, Darwin, of course, published The Origin of Species, which revolutionized the world. How does natural selection work? So all organisms have the potential for exponential growth. That is, even slow-breeding elephants, Charles Darwin wrote, would cover the globe in a surprisingly short period of time if they didn't die. But most populations do remain relatively stable, despite the potential for exponential increases, which basically means that a lot of individuals are dying or not reproducing. That's the first observation, and that came for both Wallace and Darwin from reading Thomas Malthus's essay on the principle of population, which was about the nature of limits on human population growth. The second observation is that individuals within a population don't look the same. They can vary in color, shape, size, their traits, their behaviors. So they're not identical. And if those traits that are not identical influence survival or reproduction, then they're going to differentially contribute to the next generation if they're inherited to their offspring. So the prediction then is that traits that are going to improve survival should increase in frequency, if they're Mendelian, for example, or they could increase or decrease in size or average value if they're polygenic. There wasn't a lot of evidence for this occurring, and so Darwin had to marshal evidence from a whole bunch of different things. And in particular, he used artificial breeding by domestic breeds of pigeons and many other things to show what humans could do by selecting on traits. There are many examples of how artificial selection can do that. Here's just one of them, where you took an original population looking at the bristles on the abdomen of Drosophila, and you just arbitrarily select individuals that have few bristles, and in another population, individuals that have lots of bristles to be the ones that reproduce the next generation, then you can cause the really rapid evolution of a population with low bristles and the really rapid evolution of a population with high bristles. Natural selection is driving rapid evolutionary changes all around us all the time. It's one of the things that my lab tends to focus on a lot, and many other labs study this. So if you go to Galapagos, to this very small island called Daphne Major, in 1976, so in a normal wet season you had lots of plant reproduction, and in a drought year you have almost none, and I described in the introductory materials that meant that the seeds were depleted in the ground, which meant that only the large-beaked finches could survive because they were the ones that were capable of cracking the large hard seeds that remained, which meant that when the rains came back and there was reproduction that occurred, it was the large-beaked birds that contributed more to the next generation. And beak size is highly heritable, So you saw in just a single generation a shift of about 10% in the size of the beaks in one generation. Really rapid evolution. So if you track populations in fine enough details, you can see the evolution of the traits through time, and you can ascribe particular components of that evolution to different forces. So for example, you see that sharp increase in beak size, that was attributed to the drought. And so some of the genes underlying that heritable trait variation in Darwin's beak size have been identified, and you can also show that during those periods of rapid evolution, the genes that underlie those traits, the allele frequencies are changing. And we contributed to this by understanding the genetic basis of trait of beak size variation in Darwin's finches. And we identified one particular gene that was having a really big effect on beak size in Darwin's finches. This was confirmed by another group. And you can see that the frequencies of the alleles in the Daphne major population at HMGA2 are changing during that time frame. So you can show the evolution of the average values of the traits and the genes that are underlying those quantitative traits. Now, when I've been talking about natural selection, I've been talking about survival and reproduction. Now, an important part of reproduction is mating success. So particular individuals might have really high mating success and therefore contribute a lot more to the next generation. This is the realm of sexual selection, which is often considered a subset of natural selection. There are two major forms of sexual selection. One is intrasexual, that is competition within a sex, and intersexual selection, that is the choice by members of one sex for particular individuals of the other sex. So here's one example, and that is this crazy tale of the widow bird. And if you watch this widow bird display, you can see that it also not only has this crazy tail, but it uses it in a really aerodynamically inefficient way. It hangs it down when it flies and does this crazy flight, which can't be good for energy expenditure and it can't be good for predator avoidance. So the argument is that it's attractive to females. So they took some and just left them alone. Those are the normal ones here. For other ones, they did a control, that is they clipped the middle of the tail and then they glued it back together again, its original size. For other ones, they artificially shortened it by taking the tail, cutting it in two places and pulling out a piece and then gluing back the short end onto the stub. And then they took that piece to other ones, clipped them in the middle, extended them and stuck the new piece in the middle to artificially lengthen it. Ones with artificially lengthened tails, females preferred and they had more mates. The ones with artificially shortened tails, females did not prefer and had fewer mates. Mosquito fish have a thing called a gonopodium, which is this projection here off the anal fin. And what that is that's used for transmitting sperm into the female. These researchers asked, why do male mosquito fish have such long gonopodia? Here are some hypotheses. One is it aids in what's called sneaky copulations. That is, the female's not paying attention, the male comes along and extends its gonopodium and sticks it into the female and tries to fertilize her eggs inside the female. Another option is that hypothetically, it might be male-male competition that's intimidating rival males. They look at the size of the gonopodium on their rival male and say, oh, I can't compete, I'm out of here. And then you could have the possibility that females like it, so it impresses females. Research shows that it aids sneaky copulations and it impresses females. They showed females videos of the males and they digitally manipulated the length of the gonopodium, and females preferred males with longer gonopodia, just like female widow birds preferred males with longer tails. Why isn't it longer then? So here are some other hypotheses for that. Well, it's awkward, it's a real drag, it prevents them from swimming properly, scares females, exaggerated traits can sometimes cause damage to females during mating. Now, research shows that, in fact, it's a real drag. Here is a representation of a number of different males with different gonopodium sizes in relation to how fast they can burst swim away from a simulated predator. So here are a bunch of different populations. Some of them have tons of predators and some of them do not. And you can see that the average gonopodium length is greater in populations that aren't exposed to predation. So natural and sexual selection are acting in opposition to each other. Sexual selection favors the exaggeration of some crazy traits that are important for choice by females, But they don't get too exaggerated because natural selection acts against them. For example, survival in the face of predation. And that might explain why you have large numbers of these ridiculous traits that many species show, particularly males. So the last evolutionary force I'm going to tell you about is gene flow, and I just want to give you a flavor for it, for sake of time. And that is the idea that if you have two different populations, then the exchange of genes between them means that they can't evolve independently. So think about those mosquito fish. You have the population without predators that should be evolving long gonopodia, and the population with predators that should be evolving short gonopodia. But if they're connected by a stream, then there'll be long gonopodium individuals swimming into the short gonopodium populations where the females will mate with them, and vice versa. If that occurs, this population can't evolve really long gonopodia because it's constantly getting short gonopodium genes, and this population can't evolve short gonopodia because they're constantly having long gonopodium genes coming into it. Gene flow, however, can also bring important genetic variation from one population into another, and so gene flow can have both positive and negative contributions to evolutionary divergence.
So I just want to close with a little voiceover converting these evolutionary processes that I've just described within species into the idea of the splitting of one species into many, thereby creating the diversity of life. And the basic idea is that if different populations within a species, say in different locations, like populations with or without predators, if they're evolving differently, they might diverge so much that they no longer mate together. So that is the evolution of reproductive isolation, which means that gene flow becomes zero between diverging populations, which means they become separate species. Thereby, evolutionary processes within populations generate the diversity of new species, and thus the diversity of life across the entire phylogenetic tree at every level that we described previously.